Since the last video, I watched 908,002,000,002 videos. I looked for hidden gems, and here they are.
Hello, my name is Jeremy, and on this channel I talk about color and light. And today I want to talk about a big subject.
Like most people, I hardly ever change the way I think. But this video reached into my brain and rewired it. Jeremy Vickery runs The Lighting Mentor, dropping jaws with his portfolio. Look at this. You likely saw this video. It's fantastic. But I want to flag a lesser known one. A new way to think about beauty in art.
Once heard somebody say, actually many times I've heard somebody say, that something, you know, there's somebody who's really beautiful, that they're easy on the eyes.
He redefines beauty as easy on the eyes and breaks it down in 7 parts.
Shape, form, depth, separation, contrast, palette, and focal point. We want to make images that are so believable and so fantastic that they just overwhelm us with the beauty. When people just say, oh, it's such a beautiful image. But we know, as lighting artists, why.
It's a good mindset with a good lesson and a good teacher. Don't bother looking up the video. I've gathered everything you'll see here in a playlist that you'll find in the video description. Rigging? Terrifying. One wrong move and your arm explodes. Thank God for Dicko's rigging series. 10 hours long in total and a great way to procrastinate when you're avoiding rigging. If you make characters, you have to rig. And if you have to rig, you have to watch Dicko. He actually knows all those secret little things that you have to get right because they'll make or break your rig.
I'm going to go to my remesh options here and voxel remesh that guy. I'm just going to skin this guy to my armature. Now watch what happens now when I manipulate the spine. It's moving all together as one. So what we can do is use this as a data transfer base for all of our official objects. So check this out. Go to the data transfer and we're going to make the source GeoHead001. Whoa, how about that? We got some proper deformation now.
How clever is that? This series actually gives you all the fundamentals that you need to rig a character. I love this guy. Dickoheads unite. Shout out to Ames Media 4447 for recommending this series. Keep the suggestions coming. Blender Studio, most known for Spring, I guess? Their job is to test the software, as in push Blender to its limits and find new workflows. And in the process, they write a blog about it. That is where you'll find cartoon shading with geometry nodes, a clever way of shading for cartoons inside of Blender. And of course, it's read by millions of industry prof- 12 likes? Guys, you and I, when we make NPR, we put a shader to RGB into a stepped color ramp. That is not how Wingit does it. They do it differently. Instead of using lights and surfaces like you normally would, they fake all that inside a shader. And the shader blows my mind. But I won't actually tell you how it works because the article is paywalled. Did he really recommend something that's not free? To us, to Blender users, of all people, doesn't he know that we are frugal human beings who rely on free software in order? Listen, skip Starbucks once and give that money to the people who actually make your favorite software and get world-class look dev in return. It's a no-brainer. Jesus Christo, do I have to learn all these softwares? I was planning on focusing on Blender. Why do I already feel defeated? Chill. Listen, focus on Blender, but learn from other people as well. Many of the people that I consider stars don't use Blender at all. And you can still learn from them too. And when you do, you get to make stuff like this. Xertox is a generalist. They do it all. Model, texture, sim, and shading. In this scene, they show what's possible with wide-ranging knowledge. Incredibly inspiring. And a wonderfully detailed scene. It's a reminder that the small details do add up. Houdini's channel kicks ass, and when they host Simon Holmedahl, I cancel my appointments. Here, Simon shows a logo reveal. The lesson is in how to get complexity for free. Kind of. And yes, you can do this in Blender.
And here's some close-ups of just the straight-up progression of the surface. Obviously, that's not where the job isn't done there, because a lot of it is happening through the attributes and everything. We made sure that whenever that previous mesh that we saw were in contact with a particle, it would record a timestamp. So we now know when any coordinate space within this volume has been triggered. And using this information, you can generate a lot of useful stuff.
Let's break that down. You simulate the spreading of an attribute with simulation nodes. Each vertex remembers when it turned on. These on frame 5, these on frame 6, 7, 8, 9, which makes a gradient. That gradient is so useful. You run it through a modulo node, and you get a wave. Select only the edge, and there you get particles. And using vector math, everything flows in the right directions. It is super flexible. It's nerd heaven.
I almost feel like...
On which side? Like,
on all sides. Like, on the right side, near that tusk right there.
F-stoppers do photography, and that's what we do too, remember? Once the models and shading are done, we photograph it. But what for us can be an afterthought, for these guys is a whole career. They host photography competitions, and they rate submissions, and most importantly, tear them apart.
Like, it just seems so cheap, right? It's like you shot it in a zoo, and then you black out the background in Photoshop, and then you dodge it and burn it to make it look like it was shot in the studio or whatever.
Their rating system works like this. 1 is a snapshot. Anybody could take it. 2 needs work. 3 is solid for a portfolio. 4 is excellent. And 5 is world class. Okay, now imagine this was a render. What would you rate it? Okay, if not world class, it's certainly an excellent render. I say at least a 4. Now, watch the judges.
3, 2, 1. 3 stars. It's a little too heavy-handed, not with the focal length compositing, but just with the sky and everything. It's just like the colors are wacky. It just feels really fake to me.
I do not like the sky, like, at all.
Yeah.
Thing is, as 3D artists, we often feel our job is more or less done when things look realistic. But these guys don't. For them, realism is a given, and their whole job is, then what?
Let's rate it.
Oh, we never rated it.
3, 2, 1.
I'm gonna go 2.
Maybe I should go 2. Like, I'm giving it a 3 just because of, like,
yeah.
I know how hard it was to get it.
If you want world-class renders, think like a photographer. Realism? Fine. Then what?
I think a lot of people would overlook this image when compared to all the other over-the-top images that were submitted, but I love this. 3, 2, 1. 4 stars. We agree on this one. It's an excellent shot.
Train that eye by watching these critiques. At least the new ones. The old ones are kind of bad. In a scene, what aspect of filmmaking would you say has the most impact on the viewer? I say story. Story is the most important thing, because, like, while good character and good composition does matter, it can't save a scene that has a bad story. And on second place, I put sound, because a clip that's muted has none of the punch that a clip with a sound does.
Hi, my name is Marshall, and this is Waveform.
And that's why Marshall McGee is on this list.
I think it's about time we made another sound with just an iPhone microphone and a laptop. And this time I want to tackle one of the most iconic sounds in the Star Wars universe.
Here's what he does. He takes sound from games and movies, redesigns them, and explains the steps along the way. Watch him redesign a spell from Elden Ring.
So first, we gotta grab a piece of paper. To do this technique, we gotta start with some cool paper rustling sounds. The goal while we're recording this is to create that same kind of carving movement that you hear in Thunder. So don't just scrape the paper together like this. Try to get as much interesting motion as you can out of it, something more like this.
Which one's better? Trick question. That's not the point. The point is to learn and make friends along.
Orange and teal is probably the single most talked about aesthetic in color grading. And there are hundreds of tutorials out there aimed at helping achieve it.
Color grading is a minefield of misinformation. Most people are talking out of their ass, so they make fundamental mistakes. It's really hard to know who to trust. Even I have spread a little bit of misinformation on the topic. But there are two guys that you can trust on YouTube. Darren Mostyn and Cullen Kelly. This by Cullen is a good start. A video about the teal and orange look that sneaks in a mindset shift, Mr. Miyagi style.
If you can detect some measure of that harmony in your incoming image before you touch anything at all, that's an image that you can probably piggyback onto and enhance that color harmony with, right, in a pretty organic way. If by contrast, you're looking at an image that really doesn't have much of that color harmony, you may have trouble getting an orange and teal aesthetic to feel organic to the image. And that should certainly always be our goal.
Don't fight the source material. Lean into it. Try to get close to the look on set instead of fighting it in post. That is such a key idea to get.
And because we've done it with soft measures like our custom curves and with our basic offset in our balance side here, this is something that no matter what image you apply it to, it might not look perfect on all images, but it's never going to break or create artifacts or problems or make the image look worked on no matter what you slap it onto.
Understanding comics is a comic book about comic books. A similar vibe to the animator's survival kit. Scott McCloud has a gift for teaching. He breaks down how visual communication works. Stuff like lines and color, abstraction, illustrating time, symbols, exposition, and it's all a joy to read. You get surprisingly deep insights for a book that looks like this. Pure art is essentially tied to the question of purpose, of deciding what you want out of art. This is as true in comics as it is in painting, writing, theater, film, sculpture, or any other form, because the creation of any work in any medium will always follow a certain path, a path consisting of six steps. In all the arts, it's the surface that people appreciate most easily, like an apple chosen for its shiny skin. The latest fan favorite often looks better at a glance than the older artists who had the ideas and created the idioms, but were less interested in surfaces. But often, we bite into that shiny new apple, hollow. It's a cycle as old as art itself. Did you know ArtStation Learning is free now? I didn't. I'm binging the entire thing. These courses are really unique in a very important way, because they're all taught by industry professionals, and that shows, because they focus on how things actually work inside of a studio.
So he started off by giving me this Unreal Engine file, which is just a solid block out. As you can see, this is all more or less one piece, and a lot of you might already know this, but that's not really the most ideal when it comes to creating a full environment. It's great for sort of setting the mood, getting a rough sketch in as to what we want, but it's going to be our job to go through, break this up into pieces, and make it much easier for people down the pipeline to recreate this and turn this into something beautiful like what we saw on the reference board.
These teachers know how to communicate in a team. They know how to talk to an art director. Like, this is the kind of stuff that you're not gonna get from a YouTube tutorial made by, like, a talented hobbyist. They have a series on making this game environment, and it's split into 8 parts. Planning, terrain, making the hero prop, tiling textures, making a tree, making a bunch more assets, making a water shader, and assembly. And each part is 2 hours long. So you will actually learn this stuff. Pixar dropped a full course on their filmmaking approach. 171 videos on storytelling, lighting, environments, crowds, the works. And it's all free on YouTube. Except it's unlisted, so it won't show up if you search for it. And I'll tell you how to find that in the second half of this video, which you can only see on my Patreon. Link is in the description. I'll see you there. Thanks to Skillshare for sponsoring this video and for giving me another fantastic resource to share with you. I'm a big fan of Greg McEwen, so I'm pumped to recommend his Skillshare class. It is about essentialism, doing less. And after the deluge of information I just accosted you with, you may need it. It's easier now to find what you're looking for on Skillshare. They just released smarter class categories and 3 new topics: creative careers, creativity and inspiration, and AI and innovation. And to complement that, you can filter by software and material. Don't worry if it sounds like a lot, they'll help you find what you're looking for with a short quiz when you sign up. Skillshare, if you didn't know, is a learning platform for creative skills. You'll find experts teaching their craft on topics like film, illustration, design, freelance, productivity, the lot. And if you've been paying attention, you know I recommend you learn as many of these skills as you can. If you want to go all in on one topic, you'll want to check out their learning paths. Those are curated playlists of classes meant to be taken in order. You know I love playlists! The first 500 people to use my link in the description will receive a 1-month free trial of Skillshare. Get started today.